Views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hello and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. With me today is a familiar face and name to anyone who follows the Fort Wayne Comets and any other sporting events in town, Blake Sebring, News-Sentinel sport writer and columnist. Welcome back, Blake.
Thank you, Kevin.
Now, you've been doing this about 28 years, I understand, correct, to covering the Comets and
give or take.
Which You're closing in on the great Bud Goldmeyer, who you kind of succeeded.
So I don't know about that. He was mentored by him.
Now he had 35 years in. You going to make it that far?
I don't know. That's not up to me.
That's right. It's up to our boss.
So God
and God too. Yeah. Well, the big reason we had you in today is to talk about another book, which is how many now for you?
Nine.
And at least four, I think, have been about the Comets, right?
Four of them. Tales of the Comets, Legends of the Comets, Live from Radio Rinkside with Bob.
And now the show, appropriately titled. Tell us a little bit about the title, what it's about, and then we'll get into some of the details.
It's about Fort Wayne's, and not just the Comets, but Fort Wayne in general, their impact, the city's impact on the National Hockey League and the greater hockey world. It includes the World Hockey Association, the Olympics. There's some national team things in there. How Fort Wayne has really grown out of being like the seventh or eighth longest hockey market in America.
Mm-hmm. And everybody or people who know sports know Fort Wayne was instrumental in the beginning of the NBA. This is a little bit different. We didn't have anything to do with the NHL directly, but the players who have come and gone and the coaches have been very directly involved in higher levels of hockey.
And it's not just players and coaches too. It's off ice officials, it's college coaches, it's the Zamboni driver in Tampa, one of the equipment managers in St. Louis, the Blackhawks PR director was from Auburn. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff like that behind the scenes that Fort Wayne has had an impact on.
And I have to say, I think I've, being older, covered or followed the Comets even longer than you have.
And you're quite a bit older.
Quite a bit, but I do have more hair.
Exactly.
There are things in the book I did not know until I read it. Why don't you tell the folks kind of some of the unknown stories that you think are really interesting that people ought to be aware of? Not enough to hurt the sales
sure,
of your book,
sure.
of course.
One of the things I talked to Al Sims about, what it was like to be a rookie and have, you know, Bobby Orr as your defensive partner. And that was really fascinating because I had never talked to Al about that before. And it was a funny story that he tells and what it was like playing with Bobby Orr and how sometimes he got caught watching Orr instead of watching the game sometimes where he was supposed to be. Bob Asenza was a fun story because he came to Fort Wayne after basically getting booed out of Detroit and he was ready to hang him up. Except he came to Fort Wayne and he got to play with some of his former teammates from college and the minors and Mitch Messier was his college roommate. And he just said that year meant everything to him because he could revitalize his career. And he played six more years in the NHL mm-hmm. after that.
Right, he did revitalize his career. One of the interesting stories I found was about Alton White, the first black player for the Comets and one of the first in professional hockey. I didn't know really what happened to him after he left Fort Wayne. He was only here 1 year.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that and what the kind of things he had to deal with.
Alton grew up in Winnipeg, and he lived on a pretty cosmopolitan area, and he said that there was really no racism. In fact, he would read the papers and wonder if that was real, you know. And then he came to Fort Wayne, and the first time he ever experienced racism in his life was during that season because people wouldn't rent him a house. And he ended up living with another buddy from Winnipeg who was a player. And they were like Brian's song 5 years before the Bears ever did it with Piccolo and Sayers. And they ended up getting a house with Jerry Randall. And he just loved the Comets that year. I mean, he talked about how Lionel took him under his wing and Eddie and Lenny taught him so much. He said, I really learned how to become a player, a pro, and how to become a man from that season. And I carried stuff from them all through his career. And then he ended up in the World Hockey Association, which was the competitor to the NHL. And he was the first black player to score a hat trick in a major league game and the first one to score 20 goals in a season.
Well, and what you mentioned about him, I think, permeated the book in a lot of ways. People who made a very good career in hockey, looking back at Fort Wayne, saying, yeah, that was really one of the best, most entertaining and enjoyable years I ever had off the ice as well as on.
Well, and like Kevin Weeks says, he's an NHL network commentator, probably the first black commentator. And he talks about how none of it would have happened if he hadn't come to Fort Wayne. And I'm like, you're only here for a little time.
Not even a year.
But no, I mean, he was so good he got called up. But he just made, they just had such an impact on him because they're like, all right, we're going to play you. And because he, you know, he was in that year with Bruce Racine, who was the MVP that year. And they just kept throwing him out there and kept showing confidence in him. And he said that really made a big, big difference. And that was one of the most fun interviews in the book because I'm thinking, okay, Weeksy's, I've talked to him before after retiring and stuff. And I'm like, okay, if I get Weeksy, this will be the cherry on top. Well, there was about a dozen cherries on top in this book. And he called, and we must have talked for 2 hours. I mean, just raving about Fort
Wayne. And you told me earlier that everybody you called you back and was eager to talk.
It was amazing. I mean, I think, okay, I'm going to throw this fishing line out there and see if it comes back in a week or two. And they all call back the next day. I mean, it was just insane. I mean, I haven't talked to Bob Asenza in 20-some years. And he calls back the next day, you know, and, you know, I got a hold of Freddie Knipscher and Andy Bezo and Dale Purinton and all those guys, and they all call back right away. It was just so much fun talking to them. That was why this was the most fun book I had to write.
Well, I did want to mention Slapshot, the famous hockey movie, probably one of the best sports movies of all time, I would say. And I think true Comet fans know there were several people who came through Fort Wayne involved in that. Talk about that just briefly.
Sure.
The people who were involved and what their role was.
Well, Steve Hansen or Dave Hansen, I can't remember which Hansen brother.
Well, they all looked alike,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I think it was Steve Carlson was a Hansen brother. And then Bruce Boudreaux was the main scorer for the opposing team early in the movie. And then Con Madigan was Mad Dog,
right.
Was Mad Dog in the movie. And I talked to him about that, and that was fun. That's the first time I'd ever had an extensive conversation with Connie. He's still alive out in Portland. And
he was the oldest rookie in NHL history,
yeah,
right?
37. Yeah. I mean, just a character. I mean, it's like he was falling right back 40 years ago, you know, when you're talking to him, because he's that into it right away. And it's just, he is just such a character. It was so much fun.
I mean, well, before we leave the Comets, I wanted to mention Bob Chase died in the past year. You were very close to him. What do you think his ongoing legacy and place in Comet history will be?
Oh, I think it's in hockey in general. I mean, if you think about it, who ever introduced more fans to hockey than he did over his career? I mean, you consider that there wasn't radio for hockey back in the day except for the Comets, and it wasn't on TV. And the people that he inspired to become broadcasters and such. I mean, you could make the argument that no one has done a better job of introducing the sport to the general masses than Bob did.
And of course, you mentioned Mike Emmerich in the book, and that's a story you've told before. But
and Bob's story about getting the Lester Patrick Award and what that was like for him and things like that. And yeah, Mike Emmerich and his first game with the Comets, coming to a Comets game and all that stuff.
Well, one thing you haven't seen the Comets do that I'm aware of is politicize hockey, although sports in general has become quite political in a lot of ways,
sure.
The NFL particularly, but not only. Talk a little bit about that, and what role do you think the proper relationship, if any, is between social activism and sports, and how should it be done?
I don't know, but I don't know what the answer is either. I understand that the players are saying that the flag does not mean the things that you're singing about to all people, and it does not. I mean, I think we could fairly well admit that. Mm-hmm. But then what other form of protest would there be for African Americans or other minorities in society that the majority would pay attention to? And there isn't any. I mean, and they're not doing it maliciously. They're not doing it angrily. But nobody wants to talk about the things they want to talk.
I'm not sure I'd agree with you completely on that. Kaepernick was angry when he started it.
Sure.
He made that very clear. And we had the hands up, don't shoot protests mm-hmm. after the Ferguson, Missouri thing, which turned out to be bogus. Mm-hmm. So there was anger there. I think you're right. There are legitimate grievances. And now that the NFL has said we're going to spend
how many millions
on, and I guess that will end the protests. So that may smooth things over.
But then we're not going to talk about it still. You know?
Well, I think we'll talk about it depending on how they spend the $90
million. And I don't know.
I think that was in large degree a business decision by the NFL because they're taking a hit on the ratings and attendance in addition to kind of bad football.
See, I'm not sure that they are. I think it's just symbolic of where the football's at right mm-hmm. now. I mean, you talk about the attendance. The attendance has been going down for years because it's much easier and much more comfortable to watch the games at home mm-hmm. where you have the red zone and all that right. versus going to the stadium and paying $20 for a beer. Yeah.
But then the ratings are down at home, too. So that may be in part because quality of football.
Yes, I agree with that because there aren't any super teams anymore except for the Patriots.
Well, no.
There aren't any matchups. Man, I can't wait to see that game.
And like hockey, the hitting is kind of being taken out of the game in some way.
Yeah, for the health reasons, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, let's move on. Downtown Arena, that's been in the news for the last couple of years. A month ago, Mayor Henry came out and said, we're going to put it on the back burner, at least for now. Probably, my guess would be the public did not support it. A lot of the movers and shakers in town did.
But there was never a drive to educate the public about why. It was all what it could be, mm-hmm. not what it would be. It was all this grand pie in the sky. Well, if we build this, it's going to mean this. How? Why do you say that? You know, mm-hmm. Show us the facts. I mean, show us the game plan of how you plan to populate the building with events and things, mm-hmm. And where it doesn't, you know, where we're still paying off the Coliseum, essentially, mm-hmm. even though it's county versus city.
Right.
Where are those? How does that affect that aspect of it, which we're still paying for?
Well, and it was a little bit confusing to me and I'm sure the public. We had a study a couple of years ago
saying, was a joke.
Well, yeah, I mean, it put the cost at $60 million, said it would make money after the first year mm-hmm. and it would attract events. The study just released pretty much contradicted that.
Well, how does the first study ever happen without them talking to the people at the Coliseum mm-hmm. or the Grand Wayne Center or the embassy, which
right.
they didn't?
Correct.
I mean, come on, that's a snow job. Mm-hmm. And I don't care what anybody says, that was a $60,000 or $40,000 snow job is what mm-hmm. that was.
Yeah, and if the idea was to make everybody cooperate and not compete, then yeah, I know Randy Brown and others, that, you know, the embassy, as you mentioned, were a little aghast that, yeah, you know, talk to us, maybe we can work something out. Never happened.
And, well, and why don't they talk to these people beforehand mm-hmm. when they're going to do this stuff? Why don't you have all this stuff set up and ready to go so that when you make the announcement you're looking at a downtown arena, these people are behind it. Just like the Memorial Park thing with Indiana Tech. How in the world do you not talk to the veterans first on that?
Well, yeah, that's a very good analogy because they didn't even run it through the park board before
right.
they came out with it, which they would have had to do. So, yeah,
I think that's not how Fort Wayne works.
Well, I think Fort Wayne has worked that way at times. You know, you had the back people get together in the back room and decide this would happen, and it happened. I don't know if that flies anymore. We don't have the corporate juice we used to have. But, that was why people, I think, had the idea that the arena was a done deal from day one, because it was rolled out as if it was a fait accompli when, in fact, it wasn't. So I do give the mayor, I guess, credit for reading the tea leaves properly and finding out that the public didn't want it. There was no obvious way to pay for it
right.
and no obvious need for it.
Well, do you really want to put a downtown arena for two basketball teams that are really, really struggling to draw fans?
No, and would not attract concerts. They predicted 10 new events a year, which for $120 million or whatever it would have turned out to be, is not a good use of money.
No.
Interestingly, and Randy Brown talked about it after the announcement, he said, you know, this is maybe the time we can start talking about what do we do in terms of a larger venue.
Sure.
Because sooner or later, I mean, the Coliseum is
pushing. It is 66 years old.
Yeah, and I mean, they've done a very great job of updating it and maintaining it and expanding it. But yeah, you can only do that so often. So really, Fort Wayne, I think, ought to be starting now to say, look, the Coliseum's got however many years left, 20. You know, and what's our next generation plan? And should it be downtown? Should it be at the Coliseum? Because it'll take almost that long to do it right, I would
think. Well, and let's discuss this beforehand instead of just, here's a proposal, take it or leave it. You know, why can't we have discussion? Of course, this is society now where you don't have discussions, you have takes. You know, you don't have, you have opinions even if they're not, you know, relevant or informed, you know. But we need to really take our time and study these types of things.
Yeah, and how do you pay for them? And, you know, is downtown really the best place for it? And what, where would you put it? Because the cost will be much higher downtown.
I mean, the one thing you always hear about is parking. Every time that there's a venue or something being discussed downtown, it's parking. It's always parking. And that seems to be a very, very big factor that keeps getting kind of ignored.
Well, and I thought it was interesting in the study that they pointed out that the Coliseum can essentially undercut a lot of people's rents because they do have the parking. And that will subsidize, you know, the Comets are essentially being paid to play there now, which is a pretty
$70,000. I mean, that's not even two players. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but the Coliseum, my point is they get the parking, they get the concessions.
Right.
So, yeah, you know.
The Comets have told me countless times they would rather pay rent and get part of the concessions.
Because then they could market and, and control their own destiny.
Right, like the Tin Caps control Thirsty Thursdays, or you know, where they have the dollar hot dog nights or whatever too, you know.
Well, what do you think of, you know, back to the Comets, the ECHL has been here what now, 4 or 5 years?
This is six.
Hockey's pretty good on and off, but as a fan, I kind of yearn for the old days of the IHL when players, you know, most of whom you wrote about were here more than 1 year. You know, you could identify with them, get to know them.
You got to know their families.
Yeah.
You got to know what kind of people they were, too.
And they became obviously attached to the city, which may or may not happen as we move forward. So, you know, what's your take, not only as a professional, but as a fan, and when you talk to the fans, how are they reacting to the direction of hockey in Fort Wayne?
Well, the one thing you need to know right off the bat, every guy in that locker room is playing for themselves. And I don't mean that negatively, but they all think that they are, they still have a chance to move up. And if that chance comes tomorrow, they're gone. So they are playing for that first. They're not playing for Fort Wayne or the Comets per se. Now, they do a really good job with that. I'm not trying to slam them in any way, because they're great kids.
Is that that much different than it ever was, though?
Yes, it's tremendously different.
I mean, I've talked to Len Thornton, you know, and for a while anyway, he was hoping to move up. Back when there were six teams in the IHL and six in the NHL, it was almost impossible. But he still had that dream.
Kevin, this is all 23 players that are thinking that. That's why they're playing. They're not playing for the love of the game. They're playing to move up. They're playing to get better, and they still think they have that dream.
Doesn't that provide an incentive to play better, though, than if you get too complacent?
It kind of provides an incentive to play for yourself more than the team, some ways. You know, every year the Comets, they seem to get off to a 500 start October, November, and then they pick up in December. Every year. I mean, they're 32-12-2 right now under Gary Graham in December. And that's because you kind of weed out, and you get the first couple weeks, everybody thinks they're going to score a hat trick and move up tomorrow. And then, so they're not playing for the team. They're playing for their own self and maybe their line mates a little bit. And it's not that blasé either, okay? But that's their primary thought. And then it takes them a month or two to get things figured out and figure out who wants to do the dirty little work that needs to get done to win games and things. And then they get into a rhythm and they go, you know. And plus, Gary throws a lot at them, too.
And that's assuming they stay around and don't get called up. And,
right, or hurt or whatever. Yeah, or decide, I'm not getting enough power play time here. I want my agent to move me on somewhere else. And
Well, back to the book. I mean, do you have anything else you're thinking of writing about?
Oh, I don't know. I've always got three or four in my head.
I don't know where you find the time, but
that's what's fun for me. This is relaxing. This is a hobby.
Hmm. So what might come next?
I need to work on a sequel to Lethal Ghost, which was The Mystery, which came out in February. And then I've got another comics book in my head. I don't know how long that'll be till I write that. But I'm thinking more and more now I'm going to go to fiction versus nonfiction more. Hmm. And I always get new ideas, too. That's what's crazy. You know, I say that nonfiction or fiction more than nonfiction, but then I might get another great nonfiction idea.
Well, you know, I compared you to Bud Gallmeyer, but I think, you know, one day your name will probably be up there in the rafters next to him, right? I mean,
that's what happens when you get old. Yeah, but that's not why you do this. I mean,
of course I
do it to have fun every day. I mean, I am incredibly blessed. I mean, I have a job where every day I go to work and I get to meet new people. And I'm never bored. I mean, what a blessing that is. I mean, how many people can say that about their lives?
Can you really say you're never, I mean, you set through your 100th hockey game of the year and it never is like God, you know.
But I keep finding new things to write about. There's one coming up next Tuesday that I've never written about before, which I think a lot of people will be excited about.
Well, we won't spill the beans here.
But you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm talking about. And that kind of fun. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of fun things I keep finding that were just like the couple that drove from Knoxville, you know, every weekend to watch the games. I mean, I'm finding new stories still. So I'm still encouraged that way. I'm still fired up to go to the rink. And the soldier who surprised his daughter by coming home on Thanksgiving night. I mean, I'd never seen that before in person or gotten to write about that. I'm still finding stories like that that are so much fun to tell. Like Kevin St. Pierre coming back as the bus driver for Tulsa or Kansas City and then being the backup goalie and stuff. You know?
Well, and if anybody wants to read all of those stories,
we
promised our boss we'd plug the News Sentinel. So newssentinel.com, we'll mention that again at the end.
Sure.
We're going to be running out of time before too long. I did want to make sure I gave you a chance to tell people if they are interested in the book, and I hope you all are, if you're a Comet fan especially. How can they go about getting a copy?
Right now it's available on Amazon on my Blake Sebring page, and is also at blakesebring.com. And then eventually they're going to be at the Comets games for sale. It takes a long time to order, and it's pretty much out of my control. My hope is that they arrive before Christmas, but I don't know for sure.
Well, right. If you're looking for a Christmas gift, how much will it cost?
It's only $20.
Well, what a deal, right?
Yeah, well, and there's all sorts of things on the, you know, Fort Wayne Sports History is a fun book. Tales of the Comets, Bob's biography, I mean, all that kind of stuff. Those are fun.
Well, you can put them all together in a box set. And
there you go.
So
yeah.
There
has been talk about collecting all of them for charity someday.
Yeah. Well, now, before we leave, you do cover other things other than the Comets. Talk very briefly about some other stories you might have coming up.
I had one yesterday about the local pinball player who's going to start an arcade, and that one has blown up. Did one about the passing of Donnie Oferle, a tennis pro in town, and that one has gone well. I have a list of about 30.
Well,
I'm always looking ahead, you know, having fun with them.
I think all writers have things that just kind of tweak them for whatever reason. What kind of story really interests you? Is there something unique you tend to gravitate to?
No, I mean, I like to tell people stories. I mean, to me, people last much longer than the scores. You know, nobody's going to remember the score in 2 weeks, but they might remember something within the game that a person did or that the person was unique. And to me, Bud's the one who taught me that. He taught me that people are more important than scores. You know?
Well, and back to the book, there are very few stats in here.
No.
It is almost all,
right,
you know, the person behind the stat.
But there are also little tidbits and things. You know, I always got to try something special.
Well, right. And what they did on the ice makes them more compelling in terms of what they did off the ice.
Again, the stories last, the scores don't.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, Blake Sebring, thank you for joining us. We're about out of time. Thank you for being here on the Fort Report. And thanks to all of you for joining us. Be sure to check this and other episodes out, along with Blake Sebring's work and even mine, at news-sentinel.com. Thank you.